The Andromeda galaxy is coming towards us at a dizzying 300 kilometers per second. It currently sits at about 2.5 million light years from Earth, and is the most distant object still just visible to the naked eye. In the coming 4.5 billion years, it will draw closer and closer, and then it will collide with our Milky Way galaxy. If that seems a little terrifying, there's really not that much to worry about. First of all, it's highly unlikely that any of us are still gonna be around. It's very likely that there probably won't be any more humans around anyway, and galactic collisions are really not as violent as the word collision makes it seem. Galaxies in our universe interact with each other all the time. Many giant galaxies have small, irregular satellite galaxies that are gravitationally bound to it. The Milky Way has many dwarf galaxies orbiting nearby, the small and large Magellanic Clouds being two of the best known, and visible from the southern hemisphere. Some of the other dwarf galaxies are only 500 light years across, which is truly tiny compared to our galaxy with its diameter of about 100,000 light years. I can't help but wonder if there could be any planets in these galaxies with intelligent life on them, and what they would see in their night sky. Our solar system is embedded in one of the Milky Way's spiral arms, and so we see our galaxy as this band of stars across the sky, but alien stargazers might have a very different view. Andromeda also has its share of dwarf galaxies orbiting it, and along with the Triangulum galaxy, all these galaxies form the Local Group, which is a part of the Virgo cluster, which is in turn a part of the Laniakea supercluster. One of the biggest known structures in the universe, and home to about 100,000 galaxies. All these galaxies are gravitationally bound to each other, and so they often graze past each other and can greatly disrupt each other's shape if the galaxies are similar in size, or a bigger galaxy might gobble up a smaller one. In fact, our Milky Way is currently in the process of cannibalizing some of its satellite galaxies, including the Magellanic Clouds. And so these small galaxies lose matter to the bigger galaxy as gravity thugs and throws stars out of their orbits, leaving long stellar trails. As recently as 1994, another small satellite galaxy of the Milky Way was discovered and named the Sagittarius Dwarf Spheroidal Galaxy. Yeah, you better remember that it's gonna be on the test. It has looped around our home galaxy several times, greatly distorting its shape, and in the coming few hundred million years, it will get torn apart by the immense tidal forces and slowly disperse and add its mass and stars to the Milky Way, effectively merging with it. Merging is a word that does much better justice to what happens when two galaxies, well, collide. Even if we take into account the fact Andromeda is significantly bigger and contains about 1 trillion stars, while the Milky Way only about 300 billion, the distances between stars in either galaxy are too big to cause any true chaos. It's extremely unlikely stars will crash into each other. The closest star to the Sun, the red dwarf star Proxima Centauri, is about 4 light years away. To scale that down to more intuitive distances, if the Sun was a ping pong ball, Proxima Centauri would be a p 1100 kilometers away. Even in the dense galactic cores, stars are on average still 160 billion kilometers away from each other. That comes down to a ping pong ball every 3.2 kilometers. Also keeping in mind, galaxy mergers happen over long periods of time, several hundred million years. During the process, Andromeda and the Milky Way will completely lose their shape and coalesce into one gigantic elliptical galaxy. Probably similar to M87, a humongous galaxy that sits 53 million light-years away in the constellation Virgo, contains several trillion stars and a supermassive black hole at its center, which is the source of one of the brightest radio wave beacons in the night sky. Astronomers believe giant elliptical galaxies are the end stage of galaxy evolution. Scientists aren't entirely sure how galaxies formed in the first place. After the Big Bang, the universe was filled with hydrogen and helium atoms and trace amounts of lithium. One theory says that gravity pulled dust and gas together, and these clouds got denser and eventually lit up as nuclear fusion started to happen in the core. And so the first stars were born. Then, these stars drew together in bigger and bigger groups, which eventually became the first galaxies. Another theory says that the mass of what would become galaxies drew together before the stars within them were created. Big galaxies like the Milky Way and Andromeda spin relatively quickly, and so they are spiral-shaped, while in elliptical galaxies the orbits of the stars are random, and so the galaxy is shaped more like a round blob. Spiral galaxies generally contain younger stars and see a lot of star formation, making them look more blue and pink, marbled with dark dust lanes. While elliptical galaxies contain mostly older stars and don't have a lot of new stars forming, so they appear more yellow. There's no way we can study galaxy formation and evolution directly, since this happens over the course of billions of years. So scientists can run simulations using powerful computers, and we can also observe many examples of galaxies in the process of colliding and merging, and see the aftermath of such an event. And so we have a pretty good idea of what might happen to Andromeda and the Milky Way in the distant future. The two galaxies have always been gravitationally connected because of their mass and proximity to each other. It seems that in the distant past, they formed near each other but got pulled apart by the expansion of the universe. Now they're falling back to each other. In about 2 billion years from now, the two galaxies will begin to interact strongly, steal stars from each other, and their first encounter will distort their iconic spiral shapes. Trails of blazing blue, hot young stars will be flung out as the galaxies fall back to each other once more. And any distant observers will have a hard time telling where one galaxy begins and where the other ends. Depending on how much gas remains in the galaxies, the merger may come with an extremely high rate of star birth. In images of colliding galaxies taken with the Hubble Space Telescope, we can see the intense blue and bright pink of star-forming regions. Turbulence caused by the gravitational forces stirs and compresses hydrogen gas, and so a large amount of huge and bright stars are born. Another thing for scientists of the future to get excited about is the merging of the galactic cores. It's suspected that there is a supermassive black hole at the heart of every sizable galaxy, and naturally that includes Andromeda and the Milky Way. During the final stages of a galactic merger, these black holes spiral towards one another and eventually converge near the center of the newly formed galaxy. When these supermassive black holes come within one light year of each other, they will begin to emit strong gravitational waves. That means their combined mass and speed is so huge it greatly distorts space-time itself and creates ripples in the universe that move outward at the speed of light and can be detected billions of light years away. When these supermassive black holes finally merge, and their combined masses may be millions to tens of billions of solar masses, surrounding gas and dust falling into the newly formed bigger black hole may light a quasar, a source of immense electromagnetic radiation, releasing as much energy as 100 million supernova explosions. The newly formed elliptical galaxy may have an extremely active nucleus because of the black hole, but as things settle down, the rate of star formation diminishes, and the galaxy grows old, as we can see with distant yellow galaxies. Now, with all these great tidal forces sweeping stars into entirely new orbits and even out of the galaxy, and with these black holes merging, what will happen to the solar system? How likely is it that passing stars will disturb the planets and cause them to be ejected into deep space? By the time Andromeda and the Milky Way start to merge, the Sun will have greatly increased in luminosity, because as it ages, it burns through its hydrogen supply faster and becomes hotter. It's estimated that in 4 billion years, our Sun will be so hot that no life could survive on Earth anymore, and our once vibrant green and blue world will be a dry, dead ball of rock. There's no telling what will become of humanity. Maybe our distant descendants will have moved away and found new places to inhabit and thrive. Maybe there will be nothing left to suggest an intelligent species once lived on Earth. Any living observers would witness Andromeda grow bigger and bigger in the night sky until the merger begins. Either way, it's highly unlikely the galactic collision will cause the solar system to be torn apart. Like I explained before, there's just too much space between stars even during a galactic merger. There is, however, a chance that the system will get flung out of the Milky Way and become a part of a stellar trail, or it might join Andromeda instead, for as long as it still lasts. It might eventually get pushed out into the surrounding halo of the newly formed elliptical galaxy. By the time the new galaxy will have settled, the Sun will have died and become a white dwarf, a glowing stellar remnant that ever so slowly loses heat and cools down. Maybe Earth will have survived the Sun's red giant phase and spectacular end, and will continue to orbit the white dwarf Sun for billions or even trillions of years. Meanwhile, the remaining galaxies of the local group will fall into and merge with the Milky Andromeda galaxy. As enormous amounts of time pass, the likelihood of a close encounter with another star or stellar remnant increases, and so the white dwarf Sun will lose its planets to interstellar space eventually. A quadrillion years from now, it will be a lonely, cooling ball of degenerate matter, in a universe that grows ever colder and emptier as it continues to expand and distances between ancient galaxies become so immense, everything is out of reach and out of sight. The planets lost to space will crumble into dust as the eons glide by, and absolutely nobody is around to count neither the years nor the dying stars. And there's no memory of the light and life of the early days of the cosmos. These are unfathomable timescales, but in the end, I think we can consider ourselves lucky to be alive and conscious observers of the universe at this exact point in time. Even if we will miss many, many things, almost everything that will ever happen or has happened before. Our species will probably always be stargazers, but while we may have high hopes for our future, nothing is guaranteed. Well, one thing is guaranteed. Things cease to exist. You and I will die. The Earth will dry up, the Sun will explode, our galaxy will disappear into another, and all stars will be snuffed out someday. Now, that thought doesn't have to be depressing. I see it as a motivator to try and do and see and learn as much as we can with the time we're given. Thank you for watching. I hope you learned something new today, and I will see you soon.